Hello friends, let us now learn about the definition of MI, that is ST segment elevated MI. Right, in ST segment elevated MI, the definition we have universal. Definition of ST segment elevated MI. So it is of five types. First we have type 1. Type 1 here, first there will be plaque rupture. Here due to plaque rupture or fissuring or dissection, because of plaque rupture, fissuring or dissection, there occurs a primary coronary event. Okay, this primary coronary event results in ischemia, and this ischemia will result in spontaneous MI. Okay, this is type 1. Then if you see type 2, in type 2 there is a coronary artery spasm, or it can be due to coronary embolism, or it can be due to anemia or arrhythmias, or it can be due to hypertension, or it can be due to hypotension. Okay, because of all these causes, all these causes will cause either increased oxygen demand may occur, or decreased supply can occur. Because of increased oxygen demand or increased supply, this will lead to ischemia, and this ischemia will lead to MI. So this is type 2. Okay, then we have type 3. In type 3, there occurs sudden unexpected cardiac death. Here the patient will suffer from sudden unexpected cardiac death, which includes cardiac arrest, including cardiac arrest, or it can include including cardiac arrest, often with symptoms or with symptoms which are suggestive of MI, but death will occur even, but if you see, death occurs even before the blood samples are obtained. Even before blood samples are obtained, the death has occurred in the patient, or it occurs at the time before the raise in cardiac biomarkers. The patient has MI, but it takes some time for the cardiac biomarkers to raise. So even before the cardiac biomarkers have raised, there occurs death. So this is type 3, which is sudden unexpected cardiac death. Here important point is sudden unexpected cardiac death. Then we have type 4. This type 4 is mainly associated with coronary angiography, or it is associated with stents. It is associated with coronary angiography or stents. It is of two types, type 4A, type 4B. Type 4A is MI with percutaneous intervention. This MI with percutaneous intervention is associated with 5 times elevation of troponin I, whereas type 4B is MI associated with stent thrombosis. This associated with stent thrombosis has documented by angiography. Or it is documented at autopsy. This is type 4B. Then we have type 5. Type 5 is mainly MI associated with coronary artery bypass grafting. This is associated with 10 times increase in troponin I levels. So these are the main five definitions of MI. Now, what do you see in ST segment elevated MI? Okay, first and foremost, clinical features actually. You will see, first and foremost, there is acute plaque rupture can occur, has already said, or there can be thrombosis, or there can be anything which will decrease the blood supply to the coronary vessels. That is, this can cause total coronary occlusion, that is 100%, thus resulting in myocardial necrosis. Right, so now what is the main clinical feature? If you see the main clinical feature, here the patient will have diffuse chest pain which is lasting for more than 20 minutes with one of the following. So what are seen in one of the following? So you will see ECG criteria. One, in the ECG criteria, you will see ST segment elevation is seen in two contiguous legs. In two contiguous legs, you will see presence of ST segment elevation, that is 1 millimeter in limb legs. There is elevation of 1 millimeter in limb legs, and there is elevation of more than 2 millimeters in precordial legs. Or there can be new left bundle branch block is seen. Okay, this is ECG criteria. Then the next criteria, if you see, it is troponin I. Here in troponin I will show either it will show doubling of troponin I can occur, or there can be tripling of troponin I can occur above the 99th percentile. More than 99th percentile of upper reference limit, there will be doubling or tripling of troponin I is seen. Okay, then you will also see, this is third criteria, fourth criteria, this is first ECG criteria, okay, second troponin I criteria, now third you will see presence of intraoperative MI, which is diagnosed by transesophageal echocardiography, which is showing, in the transesophageal echocardiography you will see stunned myocardium. So this is criteria 3. Criteria 4, if you can identify, that is identification of intracoronary embolus. If you identify a intracoronary thrombus by angiography. So these are the 4 criteria. Among these 4 criteria, one should be present for calling it the MI. Okay? Then, if you were asked what is the, there are some one-liners, what is the diagnostic of fresh MI? Diagnostic of fresh MI is ST segment elevation is diagnostic of fresh MI. Now, you will see hyperacute. You will see hyperacute T waves are seen first in legs facing the infarcted area. You will see the hyperacute T waves in the legs which are facing the infarcted area, or you can see T wave inversion also. Okay, then you will see ST segment elevation is seen, which is called as Pardi sign. ST segment elevation or Pardi sign is seen in the legs facing the infarcted area. You will also always see these changes in the legs which are facing the infarcted area, and these are seen mainly in the first hours of post infarct. Okay, let me draw the ECG changes. Okay, this is P wave, this is S, there is ST segment elevation like this and like this. Okay, this is in acute phase, that is in average 3 to 5 hours you will see these changes. And then you will see this change slowly in recent, you will see ST segment inversion will be seen later. So this occurs in recent stages, that is in weeks to months, where you see T wave inversion. Okay, first we will see ST segment elevation is seen, and slowly you are seeing T wave inversion. Then after that T wave inversion, slowly this T wave inversion will also decrease. Okay, and finally you will see, okay, this Q wave is seen. Okay, in old you will see, that is more than 6 months, you are seeing this significant Q wave. Significant Q wave is seen. Okay, so these are the changes. So when are significant, and then you will also see significant Q waves are seen hours to days post infarct. Okay, Now, you are seeing QQ waves, right? Fine. This is post-infarct. So, when do you call it as post-infarct? What are the criteria for prior myocardial infarction or past myocardial infarction? So, any one of the following should be present for calling it as prior myocardial infarction. One, you have the patient should develop, that is development of new pathological Q waves. There should be development of new pathological Q waves with or without symptoms. Okay, then the patient should have second imaging evidence. There should be imaging evidence of loss of viable myocardium, and this viable myocardium is lost and that is also thinned and fails to contract. Loss of viable myocardium that is thinned and fails to contract mainly in the absence of non-ischemic cause. Imaging evidence of the region of loss of viable myocardium that is thinned out and fails to contract in the absence of non-ischemic cause. Without a non-ischemic cause, a small area of myocardium will undergo it becomes thinned out and fails to contract. Or if you see a pathological evidence, or if there are pathological findings of healed or healing myocardium, if there is pathological evidence of healed or healing myocardial infarction. So all these are the three criteria for post-prior myocardial infarction. Right. Now, I have said there will be these ECG changes. Now, these ECG changes depend upon the area of the lesion, right? Area of the infarct. So, we will see the blood vessel blocked, okay, and the type of MI and ST segment elevated. If left anterior descending artery is blocked, there is anterior wall MI. Okay, in anterior wall MI, there is elevation of ST segment. ST segment elevation is seen in V1 to V4 leads, 1AVL leads. Okay, if there is left anterior descending artery, if the septal branch of left anterior descending artery is blocked, then that is septal MI, which shows increase in ST segment elevation in V1 lead, 1 and AVL leads. Okay, then if there is left circumflex or diagonal artery block, so this will lead to lateral wall MI, and if there is lateral wall MI, this causes ST segment elevation in 1 lead, 1 AVL and lead 5 and lead 6, 1 AVL 5 and 6. Okay, then if we have main left coronary artery block, this will show presence of extensive anterior wall MI. In extensive anterior wall MI, there will be V1 to V6 complete anterior wall. So V1 to V6 elevation of ST segment is seen in V1 to V6, 1 and AVL. And if there is left circumflex or post descending artery, you will see presence of post. This causes posterior wall MI, which will cause ST segment elevation in V7 to V9. In posterior wall MI. This will cause posterior wall MI. What does it cause? It causes ST segment depression. It will cause ST segment depression, or it can cause ST segment flattening in V1 to V3, and you will see dominant R in V1. okay. Then if there is block of right coronary artery block, this will result in inferior wall MI, which is where you see ST segment elevations in lead 2, lead 3 and ABF leads. Okay, so these are very important. Okay, if you were asked one liner, which of the following is most sensitive? Which of the following is most sensitive in detecting intraoperative myocardial infarction? That is, lead V5 is most effective in detecting intraoperative myocardial infarction. Okay. Okay, lead V5 if one lead is displaced. If one lead is displaced, then it is lead V5 is best. If two leads are displayed, then the most sensitive is V4 plus V5, which is 90% sensitive, whereas lead 2 plus V5, which is 80% sensitive. Okay, if all three leads can be displayed, then obviously it is lead 2, lead 4 and lead 5 will almost be 96% sensitive. Only lead V5, it is 75% sensitive intraoperatively. Then these are the important things about ECG in MI. Thank you for watching.